Hi folks, today is Sunday, June 30th, 2024. My name is Peyman. Welcome to your YouTube channel. I will be speaking the English language, then I will switch to the Persian language. This is the book review, The Man in the Mirror, by Carol Gerber.
Heydar Ahmad Rad.
عرف نفسك
نبيل يوسف عزام من لبنان
نبيل يوسف عزام از اهالی لبنان
میگوید که
باید که مردم ایران مسلمان هستند و شما اینو میدونید چه انگیزه باید که شما بخواید با برادران مسلمان که در ایران بجنگید
بگول
شعب
الإسلامي في إيران هو شعب الإسلام. Was in place. This law dictated that we could not wear bright colored clothes as they were seen as a symbol of Western values that were in opposition to theirs. One of the most striking cultural differences was the perception of happiness. In Iran, it was considered a form of unholiness, leading to a ban on smiling. Optic. I remember you would be arrested if you were smiling or you were happy, they would arrest you. Another aspect of sumptuary law was the strict dress code. Wearing a short pants and short sleeve shirts, seen as a violation of their values, was strictly prohibited. Adhering to these rules was a constant internal battle. A struggle that often felt the suppression of our individuality and creativity. On page 171, the author says that Sadegh and others had ineffable air of professional. These had been trained at PLO camps in Lebanon, according to colleagues from the press corps in Beirut. On page 171, the author states that Ali Shariati was an intellectual whose writing influenced his political perspective, Sadegh perspective. Okay. On page 172, the author mentions reading Ali Shariati's paper and finding them without academic merit. She explicitly highlights his comment about Europe's decline due to Aristotle's analogical reasoning. On page 172, the author recalls her personal experience with the Quran, noting that while it contains verses about killing others, they also include verses that oppose killing others. As a witness to history, I saw how Khalkhali and others used their book, Quran, to justify execution of innocent people. On page 174, the author's perspective on the Shah is, like he says, that megalomaniac, out of touch with reality. The agent said they were subsequently informed that this was not what the US president wanted to hear. The author is omitting facts from readers. During an interview with Mike Wallace, the Shah of Iran denied being a puppet stooge of the US and refute this US characterizing him as a megalomaniac who put US interests first. Without going any further, there are some video clips that you will be watching, and it is my first-hand account at the hands of people who engage in a psychological and physical torture people like me in Iran, and they were getting a kick out of it. They are like a really psychopath, the Islamic Republic of Iran. And you could see it for yourself why the Pahlavi dynasty collapsed, because the US and other European countries believe the Shah of Iran was not going to give them oil for free, and they want him to go. That was the whole reason. They stage revolution in Iran. They destroy Iran and they drag the Middle East on fire. I will be speaking the Persian language. با درود فراوان به همه عزیزان. خب این قسمت گفتار 14 برای شماها خیلی واضحه. خیلی از شماها تجربه تلخی داشتید از جمهوری اسلامی. یه سریاتون تو زندانی هستش به نام ایران که همه رو کردن اون تو، دارن همه رو از نظر روحی و جسمی شکنجه میدن. حالا در ایران چی شد؟ اولین کاری که کردن اومدن لباس ها رو چجوری باید لباس بپوشیم. رنگ های روشن ما حق نداشتیم اون موقع تو ایران بپوشیم. پیراهن که آستین کوتاه یا شلوارک بپوشیم بر علیه دینشون بود، حق نداشتیم. و این خانوم میگه من نمیفهمم که چرا اینها تو موقع این همه ناراحت هستن. شما این ویدیو کلیپ رو تا آخر نگاه کنید و میبینید که چرا اینا مردم آزار هستن، چرا روانی هستن، چرا افکار پریشان دارن. فقط افکار پریشانیشون باعث این من و توی که ماها رو باید یه جوری ناراحت کنن. بعد در رابطه با علی شریعتی، علی شریعتی واقعا اکادمیک نبود، درس نخوند، درس خونده بود. میدونی چیه؟ من تو کانادا دانشگاه رفتم. اگه شما میخوایید از دانشگاه فارغ التحصیل بشید، وقت ندارید موی سرتون رو بخورید، وقت ندارید اینجوری کنید. خیلی سخته. هر روز باید چندین کتاب بخونید. به فرض مثال یک درس میگیرید، سه تا کتاب داره، باید اون سه تا کتاب رو در ظرف 4 ماه بخونی و تمام اون مطالب رو به هم دیگه رد کنی. اگه نتونی این کار رو کنی نمره نمیگیری. خیلی سخته. به علاوه اون باید کتاب های بیشتری هم خونده باشی که نشون بدی که چقدر در اون مطلب بلدی. اینا دنبال این نیستن که چرا به فرض مثال پیمان اینجا نشسته. میدونیم چرا اینجا نشسته، ولی اون نیروها رو باید نگاه کرد که چرا پیمان اینجا نشسته. اون نیروها رو نگاه میکنن که تو چقدر عمقی کتاب خوندی، چقدر زحمت کشیدی. البته این در دانشگاه UFV به من رخ داد، در دانشگاه تورنتو اینجوری نیستش. به چشمت نگاه میکنن، به اخلاق خوشش میاد نمره میده، اگه بابات داره پول میده به دانشگاه بهت نمره میده. اونجا اونجوریه. خب جالبیش اینه که دوباره تکرار میکنه که ایشون که چمران و صادق و قدس‌زاده و اینا در PLO بودن، با یاسر عرفات تمرین های تروریستی داشتن. بعد از اون میاد در رابطه با قرآن صحبت میکنه که آره قرآن مثلا تشویق میکنه، با اینکه مثلا یه سری چیزا هستش که مثلا سوره هستش و گفتار هستش که میگه آدم بکشی، ولی در برابر در مقابل اون هم سوره هستش که میگه انسان دوست بشه. اینا داستانهای خیلی مفصلی داره، تو اینجا اسکوپش نیست، گنجایشش نیست که سوره های مکه داریم، مدینه داریم. تو اون زمان محمد ضعیف بود، نمیتونست کاری کنه، برای همین دوستتون دارم، قربونتون بشم، عاشقتونم بوده. بعد از اینکه قوی میشه شروع میکنه مردم رو قتل کردن. همه این زمینه ها رو باید در مد نظر داشته باشیم. اینکه مثلا قرآن چیه میتونیم خیلی مفصل در رابطه باهاش صحبت کنیم که به چه صورتی هستش. ولی خودش خلخالی رو دیده بود، خلخالی رو دیده بود که چجوری آدم میشه. شما یه ویدیو کلیپ در رابطه با خلخالی هم خواهید دید تو اینجا. اعلیحضرت همایونی سیایی گزارش میده با مایک والیس، میبینید اینجا دارن صحبت میکنن و در اونجا مایک والیس میگه که خب شما یه آدمی هستید بسیار خطرناک برای اون آمریکا، هدفهایی که آمریکا داره، اون انترست هایی که آمریکا داره، اهداف آمریکا. شما خل هستید، خیلی مذهب نمیخواستم به اینجور صحبت کنم در رابطه با اعلیحضرت، ولی مایک والس بهش میگه خل. خب اعلیحضرت میگه من چه نوع خلی هستم؟ من برای شما کاری نمیکنم، منافع کشور خودم رو در مد نظر دارم، این وظیفه منه، وظیفه یه پادشاهه که این کار انجام ده. بعد میاییم به قسمت های ویدیو کلیپ دیگه میبینید، امیدوارم خوشتون بیاد، روز پر از زیبایی رو آرزو کنید.
Are you aware of a CIA psychological profile about you, sir?
No, I must admit that it's the first time I hear that.
Truly?
Yes, what is it?
Would you be interested in hearing what the CIA had to say?
Yes, why not?
Really?
Yes, why not?
I have your permission?
Yes, sure.
You won't send me to the SAVAK if I ask?
No, I would spare you this terrible ordeal of going through torture.
This secret study portrays the Shah as a brilliant but dangerous megalomaniac who is likely to pursue his own aims in disregard of U.S. interests.
So how could I be your man, your agent?
How do you mean?
Safeguarding your interests.
Well, it says that the Shah is an uncertain ally. His dreams of glory apparently...
Oh, I know. So you would like me to be your stooge?
Do you want me to go on, or shall I forget about this?
Well, funny points, why not?
So he went on to quote to him from the CIA profile. His dreams of glory, it said, apparently exceed his ability to finance them. When his oil revenues run out in an estimated 2 decades, he might use his new military power to seize some neighboring oil fields. Shall I go on, or would you prefer that I stop, sir?
Well, the question is that I have now that you mentioned, I have seen that appearing in papers, but I think it's lots of imagination in that.
The Pahlavi dynasty has to go. There's no choice, in my opinion. We don't want that government. Now, that's a message to the whole world, and especially the influential countries, including Britain, the United States, and, of course, Iran.
Max McCarthy worked in the U.S. Embassy. The Shah dreamed of a new Iran. Development programs plunged ahead. The government scrapped all previous economic plans and went for 25% growth. The oil boom transformed Iranian society. New important jobs in the expanding industries, new business deals with new fat commissions at the end of them. A new lifestyle that no longer just apes, but tries to outdo the West.
Okay, you have raised the price of oil 4 times to repatriate those pounds and petrodollars.
But this week, the voice that may well decide the future of the country comes not from Tehran, but from Paris. This French street is now the base of a religious government in exile.
As far as we are concerned, we are not the toys of any country, including the United States.
Why is all Putin?
Because, first of all, they belong to us. And anyway, for us, our life depends on the security of navigation there, because sometimes to come our main source of revenue will be the outflow of oil.
But if the question isn't settled by the end of the year, are you prepared to take the islands by force?
It's not a question of being prepared. This is not even discussed.
Sadek Sibakalem Mofred was a student at Bradford University in England.
Who was actually making the decisions about tactics and opposition to the regime, whether it was killing, whether it was sabotage or whatever? Who was basically dictating the pattern of tactics?
Well, we were primarily against the regime. But to answer your question, as to who guide us for our tactic, it was, as far as I know, it was after a sitting that we had in Germany, and there were some Arab extremists who later on we found that they had links with Habash and some other Palestinian extremist group. In fact, it was after this sitting with these people that we decided, after a lot of conversation with them, that the tactic from now on should be a sabotage, assassination, in simple word, urban guerrilla warfare.
But whenever these decisions were taken at various meetings, the point that I'm trying to get at is that it was non-Iranians, basically, who were taking these decisions?
Well, because non-Iranian were much more involved and much more politically minded than we were, naturally, whatever they told, we accepted it, because we look upon them as a people who know better than we do. So whatever they said in the respect of the tactics of the movement, we accepted it as a good experience.
And who was, as far as you know, and you were involved with carrying money from Britain to Iran, that's who right. was providing the finance for the guerrilla terrorist activities inside Iran?
Well, first, we thought that it was money that the Iranian people had collected, our friends, Arab students, Palestinian students, Greek students, etc., had collected. But later on, when I got back to London, and I got to know more of these people, I found out that the money came either from the Habashist movement or from Libya.
Mofred was arrested while delivering funds from the sources he named to an Iranian terrorist group. He got 3 years. In England, he was a principal officer of an Iranian students' organization, which now claims he was tortured and murdered in Iran.
شما خودتون معرفی بفرمایید که شغلتون چیه، چند سالتونه و از کی فعالیتتون شروع شد و کی به زندان رفتید و چند سال زندانی کشید؟
من محسن مخملگاه تا کلاس نهم درس خوندم. 2 سال همراه با فعالیت سیاسی تو بازار کار کردم در رابطه با یه گروهی که خودمون درست کرده بودیم به اسم بلال، و سال 53 مرداد ما تو یه درگیری دستگیر شدم.
خب کی آزاد شدید از زندان؟
تقریبا عید قدیر پارسال 57.
شما هنوز با ایده خودتون پابرجا هستید؟ خب حالا که انقلاب پیروز شده، قسمت عمده شده، قسمت اصلیش، بفرمایید که از این به بعد چطور معتقدید که مبارزه ادامه پیدا بکنه و انقلاب تداوم داشته باشه؟
البته من یعنی گروه ما از قبل معتقد بود که مبارزه صرفا نمیتونه با رژیم باشه، یعنی چون ما میخوایم اسلام پیاده بشه، طبیعتا هر چیزی که مقابل اسلام وایسه باطل میدونیمش، و منتها اشکال مبارزه با باطلهای مختلف فرق میکنه. یه سری باطلهای ایدئولوژی که اینا رو باید برخورد ایدئولوژی کرد باشون، یه سری برخورد سیاسی میکنن همینطور، و یه سری هم مثل رژیم و بعضی از مثلا اصحاب همین گروهایی که الان دست به اقدامات مسلحانه علیه انقلاب میزنن، اینا رو باید باشون مبارزه مسلحانه کرد.
یعنی همه جور مبارزه شما معتقدید؟
بله، یعنی من معتقدم مبارزه حق و باطله، باطل هم اشکال گوناگون داره و با شیوه های مختلف، یعنی باید مبارزه ایدئولوژیک سیاسی نظامی درون سازمان های به اصطلاح اصیل اسلامی که من خودم الان
Oh.